Scoop, using these credentials, will connect to a database. It will connect to database. Once it connects to database, it will start read the metadata. It will start read the metadata. Whose metadata? Whose metadata? Look at guys here. Whose metadata? Suppose, let's assume that I want to bring the data of a table called employee. I will write a query such a way that scoop import connect JDBC MySQL localhost --- username --> password . This is the symbol to line break, guys. Okay, don't worry about the symbol. The symbol is not mandatory. The symbol is line break. Let's say you are not able to type in a Linux environment in a single line. So if we'll give like this, this is just like line break. So line break means whatever you write after the slash, it will treat as a single line. It will treat as a single line. It will not treat as a multi line. That's the only use of the symbol. --- table. This table name is employee. Okay, so this is my query. What this query will do? What this query will do? As soon as you execute this query, your scoop will connect to RDBMS. RDBMS using this URL, and using username and password, and for this specific table, it will connect to that RDBMS and start read metadata of table called employee. Metadata will be the table will be having a metadata, so your scoop will start understanding the metadata of employee. Metadata of employee. It means what is the primary column, what is the what are the columns are available, and how what are the columns are available. It will start understanding the data, what is the delimiter, and start understanding the metadata about employee table. Okay. And once it understands the metadata information about the employee, then it will create a Java code. Why it will create a Java code? Why? Because the scoop that has to be executed as a job. Scoop internally launches a MapReduce job. To launch a MapReduce job, it has to prepare some Java code. It will connect to the RDBMS and reads the metadata, then prepares the Java code, which you really no need to write. It will write the Java code. And the Java code name will be, so when you say Java, the Java will be having a class name, right? Class name will be as same as table name, and when it compiles, when it runs, the file name also as same as the table name. File name also as same as the class name. Let's say, let me put it like this. File or class name will be as same as that. And once it is completes the Java code, it will compile the code. After compiling, it will generate the dot class file. And the dot class file also will be the same name. And it will create a jar file. Why we need to create a jar? Because any Java application, if you want to run, we will launch as a jar. But for our understanding, for our learning, we will be not creating a jar. Suppose if I have developed an application, I want to give that application to you. I cannot give file as the different files. I cannot give file wise. What I will do? I will do a build. Build means compiling. Once I compile, it will generate a dot class files. All these dot class files will be wrapped together. That's wrapping is nothing but jar. Java archive. The wrapping is nothing but Java archive. That is something dot jar. The jar also will be same name as your table name. After creating a jar file, it will launch job. It will launch job. What the job will do? It will go and start reading your table. It will store and start reading your table, and it will fetch the data, and will fetch the data. It will put into a HDFS. It will put into HDFS. It will start read the data and will put into HDFS. Understand, guys? I'm repeating one more time. As soon as you give the command, like import command above, as soon as you execute using the with the help of the JDBC URL or JDBC libraries, it will go and connect to the database, and using username and password. So you have to specify the database name also here. I missed to specify. You have to specify the database name here. Slash. Slash. Let's say retail_db. We need to specify the database name also. So it will go to the respective database by using this username and password. It will connect. It will go to the table. It will start understanding the table metadata. Table's metadata, because then only it can prepare the Java code. It will start read the metadata information. What is the table name? What is the columns? What is the primary key and all? Then start create a Java code and dot class file and dot jar file, and it launches a job. And one thing what we need to remember here is your sqoop internally uses the MapReduce. What is the MapReduce? We keep hearing about MapReduce. We know that what is the MapReduce. MapReduce is a processing tool or component or design pattern or programming paradigm where we can process the data in parallel fashion. Map and reduce. Here sqoop uses map only job. Map only means, as I told you, you have two operations. One is a map operation, other one is a reduce operation, right? One is a map operation, other one is a all maps are completed, there is something called reduce operation. If you don't have a reducer, we'll call as a map only job. We'll call map only job. So anyway, we'll be seeing them in the map reduce when we are discussing. So that will be our next component. So your sqoop internally uses the map reduce job, map only job, I can say. It will start, it launch map only job. What it will do, whatever the, see, let's assume that I have a table 1, 2, 3, 4, Sarika, Surya, Lakshmi, Brahmi. Okay, and 100, 200, 300, 400. Let's assume that this is a table. Okay, this is the table. Let's assume that you have some more records like this. Now this data has to be bring to HDFS. As I told you internally, it uses the map only job. When I say map only job, it is a parallel fashion. It is a parallel fashion. So parallelly process the data. It will parallelly process the data. So your sqoop job by default, it will launch four jobs. Four parallel tasks. Four parallel tasks by default. By default, four. You can change it, but by default, it is four. Now, I need to download these records. Let's assume that I have 100 records. I have 100 records. This 100 records file or 100 records data has to be parallelly processed. It means it will divide the data into four parts. This will be processed by mapper 1. This will be processed by mapper 2. This will be processed by mapper 3. This will be processed by mapper 4. It means four parallel process will launch on that specific table, right? And it has to divide the data into four parts. How it will divide? To divide the data, I should have some unique property. Yes or no? I should have some unique property. Suppose if I want to divide something, I should have some unique property. Let's say I want to segregate males and females. There should be some gender. Gender is a unique property, right? So all males will go one team and all females will be one team. So when I divide like that, I'll be having to separate it, I should have one property. So here also, to separate it, I need one property. I mean, I need to divide into four parallel parts, I need some component. So that's where it started understanding metadata, no? So in the metadata, it will start look for the primary key. Primary key. What is the primary key? Let's assume that in this, ID is the primary key. Let's assume that ID is the primary key in this case. If ID is the primary key, what it will do? It will take a minimum value of your ID. Where is the cursor? It will take the minimum value of the ID. What will be the minimum value? 1. And it will take the max value of your ID. Let's say it's 100. Then start divide 4 parts by 4. By 4. 100 by 4 it means 25 records. So what it will do? 1 to 25. Whatever the number falls under this range, 1 to 25, whatever the numbers, I mean, whatever the employee IDs falls under this range, it will process by mapper 1. Guys, try to understand. It is not the rows. It is not the rows. It is a range. It is a range. That's what I'm trying to say here. It will find the maximum employee ID, minimum employee ID, and maximum employee ID by number of mappers, 4 mappers. So 25. It has to come, 25 is the upper bound, this is the lower bound. 1 to 25, in this range, it can be 1, 10, 20 like that. No need to be 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, whatever falls under this range, it will process by mapper 1. From 26 to 50, whatever the employees falls under this range, mapper 2. 51 to 75. Whatever the range falls under these numbers, it is not a record count. Don't get confused with the record count. Records may be 90 only, or records may be 80 records only, but employee ID can be bigger, right? So whoever falls under this range, it will go to mapper 3, and 75 to 76 to 100. Whoever falls under this range, it will go to mapper 4. So four parallel process will launch, and it will get the data and put into HDFS. And four part files, it will create a four part files, part m00, part m01, part m002, part m003. It means because four parallel tasks, four outputs, four files, for each output is a file. Any doubt so far? Sarika, Surya, Manoj? Yeah, go ahead, Manoj.
You said the record can be less. For example, if you say there are only 80 employee IDs, The blocks will not be in M1, M2, M3, M4. It is not necessary that the data should be equally distributed, right?
No.
For example, if we have the that's my concern. If we have 50, for example, 80 data, 1 to 30 is coming and 50 to 75 is there. Like that, it's not evenly distributed. Then it will be only in some of the blocks, right? M1 or M3, M4, and M2 can be empty also, right?
Yes, obvious.
Yeah.
And that's the reason sometimes you will find empty records, empty files, empty part files.
What is the reason the splitting based on the maximum and minimum employee ID, Ravi? Then here the blocks are empty, right? Some of the blocks are empty. And some of the blocks will hold more data, right?
The range, yeah. So you are telling that take the row count. If it is 80 by 4, you take 2. So who will calculate?
Yeah, right.
How will you calculate the row count? You have to launch another job like counting the rows, right?
Okay.
Instead of that, I can find easily minimum and maximum from my employee ID, right? So all the databases will not support the row count also, right? Right.
Okay.
So any other doubt, Sarika, Manoj, Krishna? Yeah, Krishna, go ahead.
Yeah, you are doing the 1, 2, 3, 4 IDs, right? This is the our integer value. It's auto increment key, something like that only. But suppose if it is alphanumeric keys also, we are seeing that one.
No.
That is also equal to.
No, if it is alphanumeric, it is quite difficult. We will see that option in the guide. It has to be a number.
It should be an integer value.
Yeah.
It's a unique value.
Unique value.
And, one more thing, you are 100 by 4, right? This 4 is divided into this internal operation, or we have to specify the value?
You can specify by default 4.
Oh, how many records are there? Suppose 1 lakh records also there, divided by 4, right?
Yeah, even 1 lakh records are there, by default it will go 4. You don't want to launch 4 because of the it will take the so much of performance aid. You want to give 10.
Okay.
You can give 10 by specifying minus M here. Along with
We can set the dynamically, right? You mean to say.
In the query itself we can set here.
Oh, okay. Okay.
You can set like this by minus M. We all see these things, you know, it will make you familiar. Yeah.
We can even reduce that count from 4 to 1 or 2, Ravi, or is it mandatory to always have 4?
So by default 4, when you say minus M equal to 1, it launch 1 only. When you say minus M equal to 5, it launch 5. That's what you have an option with a minus M, like minus minus table, you have something called minus M.
Okay.
In the query, what you'll do, you have given minus minus table here, right? Like this minus M you give and you say 1, it will launch only 1. If you didn't specify minus M, this option, if you didn't specify, by default it will go with the 4. Any questions?
I have a question, Ravi. You said like if we have like if we specify or not, it's a 4. But how it will divide the 4 is based on a primary key, and that should be an integer, you said, right? But it might not be like the case for like in all the records. For example, as I said, like retail data, sometimes like those are scenarios like we might not have a unique identifier in a table. For example, imagine that we have a like store ID and a product SKU details. I know those are all identifiers, SKU details, a product SKU descriptions, and amount, quantity of the amount, like how many we sold of the product. These are only available. So in that scenario, how it will divide those like by 4 or by 5, how many jobs you want to run.
Okay. So if it does not have a primary key, it cannot launch a parallel job. It will fail the job actually. Saying that I'm not able to identify the primary wala, unique column. You give me one column name which is unique, because we will be knowing that, right? We have to know it because we are going to process the data. We should know that. So we before you write your script or before you write all this process, we should understand the data, then we will write. Correct, right? So we need to supply a column which has the numeric. See, which has the numeric and which has the like. Ideally, it's a primary in the sense I'm not expecting you to be each and everything is the single row only. Okay. Mm-hmm. It can be a non-primeric, but it has to be a numeric. It can be a non-primeric, but it has to be a number type.
Int. Okay.
So then I can find the range, minimum range and maximum range.
Okay.
So why it look for the primary key, but if it have why it look for the primary key? It's easy to find what is the minimum value, what is the maximum value. Anyway, I'll show you that with the example. You can easily understand that. Any other doubt? One second, guys. Yes, Sandeep. Sorry. So start check the all the what are the services are running in the previous JPS. It's showing that Kafka, Zookeeper, or consumer producer or something, right? Those are related to Kafka. Now I started all the services. Why I need to start all the services? Because your Scoop tool internally uses the MapReduce. So MapReduce services are required. The results will be stored into the HDFS. The Hadoop services should be running. Okay, so let me check whether I do have MySQL or not. Return score. Who are not from SQL background, please start learning the SQL. And I know that we do have most of them are SQL background. And show tables. So now I'm going to get the customers data. Okay. Look at how many records are there in the customers. Select star, count star from customers, right? I have 1,235 records are there. I'm going to import these records. Okay, so the command which I'm going to write it here, sqoop import. Why I have to use import? Because I'm going to import the data. Sqoop import minus minus connect JDBC colon MySQL colon slash slash localhost wherever your Hadoop database is running slash retail underscore db space username password table. That's it. I'm not going to specify anything else. Sqoop import username, password, and table and customers. It is starting a job. If you closely observe this log information, okay, I'll show you. It is started connecting your resource manager because it has to launch a MapReduce job. This interruption, don't worry. Number of splits 4. And look at guys here. From here, I want you to understand this. I'll explain this. Let it finish the job. And you can also see your job in this. When the job is launched, you can go to your browser, click here, paste the URL, whatever the URL you got it from there, press enter. It will show you that the job is running. Map and reduce, map operation, reduce operation. You can see UI of this job. It's taking so much of time. It's a MapReduce application. Look at here. Total maps are 4. How many are completed? Reduce progress. Total reduces. Whether the reduce is completed or not. So it is still in progress. It's still running. Total maps are. Still it's going on. Let it go. It's completed. So actually we need to refresh. It's gone because it has hanged. That's the reason. No problem. The job is completed. You can look at here. These are called counters, guys. Counters means the statistics of your job. How you not to worry about the file counters and all. We'll talk about these counters in MapReduce. Okay, you try to understand here. Total maps launched. 4 mappers. I told you, 4 parallel processes. Okay, time spent all maps in occupied slots. How much time it is planned to process? This means in milliseconds. And map input records. How much data? If you go and see your MySQL, how much data? 12,435 records. How many input records? 12,435 records. How many map outputs? Map output means total records. It's a read from the RDBMS. It put into HDFS. We can check here. Sometimes some people will ask, how can I check all the records are came or not? You can check in the your counters in the MapReduce whether all the records are read and outputted or not. You can check here. Split bytes, we'll talk about what is input split. If you start talking about input split and mappers and all, it will become a MapReduce class instead of sqoop. We will talk about that later. And CPU time, how much time it is spent and how much time it is taken down. So retrieved these many records. Now Ravi, you are telling that it is fetched from RDBMS, it put into HDFS. Where it is put? Now, I told you we will talk about this. I told you we will talk about this, right? Look at guys here. What is a boundary query? Look at what is a boundary query. Select minimum of customer ID, max of customer ID from the customers. Minimum customer ID, maximum customer ID from the customers table. Let's go to your customer table. Look at guys here. Your customer ID is what? Primary key. Number type and primary key. That's the reason automatically it has taken customer ID as a, that column as for the splittable column. We will call it as a splittable column. Split by column. Split to by column. If it does not have a primary key, we have to specify explicitly by using hyphen hyphen split by hyphen hyphen split minus by. We have to specify explicitly. We have to give that. I will show you that how we have to give that option. Now fine Ravi, I can understand you connected to database, you brought the data. Now where the data is, where the data is, I think this job will be completed. You won't find that here. You won't find that here. You can see completed, finished jobs. This is our job is finished. Click on this. These are the job details. Guys, this is what we'll look into even real time. This is how we'll look into real time. We will go to this 8080 8088 port number, and it will show the, all the application, running application, submitted, accepted, running, finished, failed, killed. Ours is finished. Ours is success. This is the successful job. Go and click on this, and you'll see all the jobs. And it, oh no, it's not a task tracker. It is a, your, I can say it is your application master, where it, I can say it is your yarn. Okay, I can say where your applications are launched. Okay, and look at here. This is a job. This is a job. And this is the logs. Suppose if something goes wrong, something went wrong, you have to look into error log, out log, syslog. Just go and click on the syslogs. It will show you something goes wrong here. It will show you complete log information here. If something goes wrong, you will be having error. In our case, it's attempted twice, no? It attempted twice, if you remember. That's the reason this error. If something is wrong with your logic, or something is wrong with your code, or the cluster, or something, anything is maybe possible, right? If the job is failed, we'll look into the logs here. This is the real time question. People may ask you that where you will see the logs. Your service related, you will see in your Hadoop installation directory. Your service related, you will see here. The service related, you will go and see in these logs. You will go in these logs. If it is job related, you have to go and look at here. You have to go and look at here. Okay, and go back. And when you click on this job attempt ID, it will give you complete details like how much resources has been allocated, how many jobs has been launched. It is not showing actually. No, it is failed. It is completed. It will show 4 mappers launched, right? So it will show all the details about that. How much memory has been used, how much time it has taken. Right, if something is there, something went wrong, that it will show the error message here. Okay, now fine. So this is not our thing to, I mean, I need to go to this port number, go to browser.
Ravi, these port numbers, where it will be get configured, Ravi? Actually, you are going suddenly there to, this is the port number, this is, but we don't know exact port number for this job.
I told in the last time, right? So if you want to go to the your file browser 50070, if you want to go to your application master 8088, and if you want to go
these are predefined thing.
Yeah, these are predefined thing. You can see the host numbers from in the configuration files, or you can see your host numbers forwarded host. Let me show you that. I think there it will be there. There is some other job. The Spark jobs. There is something if you launch a Spark. I mean, anyway, the Spark is not launched. It will be Spark jobs. So these are all comes with a experience, Manoj. And if you really want to see all the port numbers, let me check. I think we should have. But Ambari, Hortonworks or Hortonworks and others, you will be having the port numbers directly there only. No, here it is not mentioned. If you go to your Hortonworks settings, if you go to network, if you go to here, you'll be having all the port numbers. Since we are using Apache, you will not be knowing them. So if you go with Ambari, Cloudera, something like that, they will be already specified which port number is meant for what. The data node 50075, and these are the different services, right? Let's say node manager 8042, Uzi 11000, Solar, this Spark 4040, just now I entered, and Web HBase, Webcat, Web HDFS 50070. That is a Web HDFS. And what we access 50070. And your Ambari 8080, Apache, some other service, it is not sure. HDFS 8020, like that. SSH 2222. So it means it will be given like this, or you can Google it, or you can find them. I mean, it's really not required. What I'm trying to say is really not required to mug up. Okay. Yeah. So where does data is stored, my customers? Where are my customers now? Go to user. Go to your user. In this users, look at here. October 5th, 8:21. I mean, 10 minutes before it has been created. Under your username, under that, the directory will be created as similar as your table name. The directory will be created as similar as your table name. Click on that. I told you will get the four part files, because four parallel tasks are launched. That's the reason you will be having a four part files 000, 001, 002, 003, and so on. If you click on this file, the files are very small, right? So part one file, if you go and click on this, if you download this and open the file, this is the data of that file. This is the data of the file. 3000 records came. Total 12000, right? So one part file got 3000. I mean, four part files close to, it's properly divided. Four mappers, right? Understand? And here there are so many other properties we need to understand, okay? We need to understand here. There are so many properties are there. Those are, what are the data? It is stored in RDBMS. It is a tab separated. Yes or no? Whatever the data is there in RDBMS, that is a tab separated by default. By default, that is a tab separated. But when it come to HDFS, when it come to HDFS, look at guys here. What is this? What is this? Comma separator. Your sqoop by default uses comma separator. By default, storage format of your sqoop is comma separator. These are all interview questions, guys. The people may ask you in interview. People may ask you in interview how sqoop is working, how the sqoop is working for parallelly, how the data is getting divided. You can tell that it will identify the primary key column, and it will identify the minimum value and maximum value based on the select query. Based on the select query, it's called boundary query. It will divide into that. Any questions?
So Ravi, can we give the split test number 5 and try it out, how it gets whether it's creating 5 files?
I want you to try.
Okay.
Same command, nothing changes. Same command, nothing changes. Only you need to specify 5.
Okay. Yeah.
So don't execute the same command one more time. Why? Because the locations already exist. It will throw an error. First you need to remove that, then you have to execute. Okay. So that kind of experiments you guys try it. Okay. That's where we'll get the more hands on. That's my intention. It's not like I am avoiding your question. Okay. So that kind of experiments, I don't have permissions. Again, it's some problem. I need to get the whole permissions for this. So why I'm asking you guys to try it? When you try it, you will get to know the new thing. So something is failed. Why it is failed? You start debugging it. Okay. If I start explaining everything on behalf of you, you will not experience that. That's the one. That's what I want to try to say. It has been removed. You can execute with the 5. Not only 5, you can execute with the 5, 6, and so that up to you whatever the number you want to give. I mean, this is my connection problem. You don't worry. It will not give an error in your case. In your case, it will be something different. We have launched with the 5, right? See the difference here.
Yeah.
Didn't copy. How many splits? Each split is nothing but one mapper. Each split, one task. Okay. That will create 5 part files. You really not worry about that. Okay. It will create a 5 part files. 0 to 4 file part files. It is processing. First it will keep everything in the temporary. You can look at here. It started processing. Still it is not completed. 0%, 60%, 100%. Now it's completed. Now go and refresh here. 0 to 5 files. You can open and see what is the last file, what contents it is. Clear, Manoj?
Yeah.
Okay. And I'll be sharing you a document. Where is our document? I'll be sharing you a document. Sqoop commands. I think it is there. Yeah, I'll be sharing the document. I want you guys to try all the examples in that. I'll share now itself. Okay. I'll share now itself. Okay. Here is the previous one was the HDFS. Here is another drive. In this drive, you have something called notes. In this, you have something called sqoop. In this, these are the documents for the sqoop. And this is the notes. Sqoop commands. If you open, you have all the list of the sqoop commands. Anyway, I'll be explaining all of them. You try experimenting yourself. Anyway, I'll explain, but still you, I want you to do an experiments. Okay. So I think I do have you guys email IDs. And if I do not have, if you don't mind, could you please ping me quickly each and everyone's email ID? Quickly. I'll copy paste. Let me see. I think I'll be having already. Okay. It's automatically it pops up. Yeah. Surya, is that yours? Surya?
Yes, Ravi, that one. Yeah.
Manoj, is that yours?
Correct.
Krishna, which is yours in this?
Hey, REO, Ravi. REO. This is the last one. Last one.
And Amar. Amar, I think you have this access already, right? This is your summer?
Yeah. I already have access to this.
Yeah. Prashant, can you tell me your email ID? This one, right, Prashant? Prashant, please. Sometimes it will be sync with my mobile. Whatever the name I say, it will sync there. Srinivas.
TEL.SRINU.
TEL dot.
The second one.
Okay. Prashant, he didn't confirm. Okay. Prashant is not there. Okay. I'll put this later. I can change. Harish, you have access already. Sarathi. Sarathi, this is the one yours? This one. And who else? I think everyone is covered, right? Nataraj.
This is Harris Center.
Okay. No, man. I have sometimes I told you, right? Sometimes it will sync with my mobile. Sometimes it will save it. Okay, so these are the shared drives. I have already shared complete drive in this. Go to notes. Sorry, the videos. Go to notes. Complete notes I have given access. Complete notes. Okay. Yeah. Complete notes I have given access. You guys can go ahead and have a look in the sqoop part. Sqoop part. You can see this is the one document. And sqoop notes and all, most of them all are already there. You can have a hands-on and you can just check with them. If you find any difficulty while doing it, please let me know. Anyway, we'll be discussing by command by command. So tomorrow I'll be explaining this list and list databases. And in import itself, I do have a different kind of flavors here. Okay, different examples. Different examples are there. Okay, I want you to try each and everything with the warehouse, with the target DAR, with the append. There are so many other options are available. Okay, that's it for today, guys. So we'll connect tomorrow. Tomorrow same time. These days I'm available by most of the times 7:30. Try to log.